Stephanie makes me think, where is it that I search for God? Where is it that I look to find my life and my meaning? Sometimes we find God in places that are unexpected. I'll start with two stories of folks that we're looking for God in somewhat unexpected places. First one was on the news recently. It has to do with something on a roof. You might have seen this picture on the Channel 13 news. I see some heads shaking. Seems that a gentleman named Freddie, who lives in Johnstown, New York, I actually lived there for a while myself. I've been born in Gloversville and lived for a while in Johnstown. Freddie really wanted to go snowmobiling with his friends up in the Ticonderoga area. And his truck broke down, so he just backed his car up to the snowbank, put his sled on it, and moseyed up the Northway. Got quite a few likes on social media, somewhat of an internet sensation. Sometimes we're looking for pleasure, we'll go to great lengths. So another story, it has to do with something on a roof, is an ancient story. There was a king that lived in a land called Balkh, which is now northern Afghanistan. The king's name was Ibrahim. He was a very wealthy man, but he was looking for the light. He was looking to be spiritually wealthy also. One night the king was roused from his sleep by a fearful stumping on the roof over his bed. Alarmed, he shouted, "Who's there?" "A friend," came the reply from the roof. "I've lost my camel." I have the next slide. Perturbed by such stupidity, King Ibrahim screamed, "You fool! Why are you looking for a camel on a roof? You fool!" The voice from the roof exclaimed, "Are you looking for God in silk clothing, lying on a golden bed?" Both Freddie and King Ibrahim were searching for pleasure, were searching for meaning. Put some things on the roof, and who knows if things turned out quite the way wanted him to. Well, anyway, the story ends with the king, and apparently he was so moved by the response of why he'd be searching for God, laying there in his silk clothes and on a golden bed, that he decided to spend the rest of his life helping the less fortunate that didn't have silk clothes and a golden bed. So maybe it helps us to start to put in perspective, what do we look for on the roof, and where do we look for God? Many of us may try to find God and solve the problems of life by logical calculating schemes. It's kind of like Freddy. If our truck breaks down, you know, we'll just drive something on the roof of the car and do it that way. And I suppose, you see, if we're passionate enough about what we want, we'll find a way for it to get done if we want it bad enough. Freddy really wanted to go snowmobiling, so he found a way make it happen. if we really look to enter into relationship with the God that was born in the manger, maybe it's more in looking into the giving and how we can help as opposed to what we can get out of it. Maybe Epiphany, following the light, is a reminder for all of us, no matter who we are, if we're a king or a politician, or rich, successful, or desperate, or poor, or dealing with cold weather, that as Christians we have a light to shine in the darkness, an illumination from God that can raise the roof on any obstacle and bring love and compassion to any situation. Some thoughts to share with you about life in 2018 that makes me think about how we share God. How are we loving and compassionate? Where is the world these days? You may not agree with all of my thoughts, and that's okay, but hopefully at least it'll spur some thoughts about how we search for the love light in the world. Because it is the thought of many, and I happen to agree, that maybe the most powerful religion today is the religion of money and power, of just getting what we want when we want to get it, and going to any means to do that. Reminds me of one of my favorite quotes that I've shared before by Jimi Hendrix: when the power of love overcomes the love of power, then and only then will the world know. I heard on the news earlier in the week, in terms of money and power, that when we look at salaries of those that make the largest salaries, those that are average, the ratio in this country is now something like 217-1, that those on the top make 217 times more those in the blue-collar jobs. And that only 40 years ago, that ratio was something like 30-1. So an 8-fold increase in 30 years, the disparity between those that make the most and those that are struggling to get by. I happen to think that that says something about the love light, says something about how important faith is in the larger culture. In England, they did a study recently, and they found that by January 3rd, and this is why this was also on the news, that by January 3rd, the richest wage earners in England made as much as the average wage earners made in the whole year. That the top earners made as much in 3 days in Great Britain than it took the rest of Great Britain to make in the whole year. Now, I'm a capitalist. I like having money. I like that my partner, my wife and I, combine our incomes, it's in the six figures, not in the high six figures, but we're there. We have cars. We can take 2 weeks off and stay at a nice place in Maine in the summer that you don't get for a couple $100 a week, because we can afford to do that. And I'm going to Florida in February for the first time in my life, and considering the weather in the last week or two, I'm really looking forward to it and can afford to do that too. So I don't think there's anything wrong about earning money and making money. I'm happy to say that one of the biggest checks we write every month is to the church, to be able to help people out, to be able to have this wonderful place that we can worship. And yet, I'm concerned that the overall mood of those that have these days is to just have more as opposed to give some back. There's a passage in the Old Testament, Micah 6:8, and the prophet Micah said to God, "What is it that you want your people to do?" And God answered, "Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly." As another verse puts it, treat people fairly. Be nice to people. Don't think of yourself too much. And I don't know, maybe it's just me, but it seems that some that have a lot just are all about themselves and how much they can get. And somehow, even though they say they follow the love light of Christ in the world, I just have trouble seeing that. And yet I know that that love light of Christ is so powerful. It is something that no darkness or no greed will ever be able to put out. And that, I think, is what makes Epiphany that we celebrate today so important. That God is indeed found in the incarnation, in coming to be with us, little old us, and in the humility of being born stable, surrounded by the poor and by animals, not in a bed with silk linens made out of gold. So maybe as startling as it is, the story of a camel on a roof is just as startling as the Christian message, the vulnerability of the life of Christ, of being homeless, and of suffering death on a cross, and to think that those are what we celebrate, those are what we give our allegiance to and our heart to, that a king, a love light, that lived a life of homelessness and died a death on a cross to show how powerful that light is, even to those that are hurting the most. Story in closing from a Hasidic rabbi named Levi. I like that name. Levi lived in the Ukraine, and Rabbi Levi said he discovered the meaning of love from a drunken peasant. The rabbi was visiting the owner of a tavern in the Polish countryside. And as he walked in, he saw two peasants sitting at a table. And they were both very, very drunk. Arms around one another, they were proclaiming their great love for one another. And suddenly, Ivan says to Peter, "Peter, tell me what hurts me." Blurry-eyed, Peter looked at Ivan. "How do I know what hurts you?" Ivan's answer was swift. "If you don't know what hurts me, how can you say you love me?" If you don't know what hurts me, how can you say that you love me? One of the reasons I think we really nailed it with our mission and vision statement, to be a loving, compassionate community following the example of Jesus Christ. And as far as my epiphany in life, a born-again experience that I had, and I tell you, having been a Methodist since the age of 18, I wasn't really expecting a born-again experience. Typically, we associate those words with the Baptist and the Methodist, but it's okay for us Methodists to have them also. So my bright light epiphany born-again experience has to do with a quote from the book, the text of Alcoholics Anonymous, that says, "Practical experience will show that nothing will so much ensure one's immunity from alcohol as intensive work with others." As you know, as I've shared occasionally, that I used to like to drink too much. But at some point, in early 1996, I met a guy, and he said, "Are you still doing that AA stuff?" And I had met him in the summer of 95, about 8 months prior. I said, "Yeah." I didn't tell him that my last drink was only about 30 days prior, in February of 96. And he said, I want to do that. I want to get sober." And I wanted to get sober, but I just couldn't quite get there. I just couldn't let enough light shine through of Christ to get over the hump. But I was told you need to share sobriety if you want to give it away. So I said, okay, let's do this step process, these 12 steps. And the first step is you admit you got a problem. Your second step is you admit that there's a God. And the third step is you get on your knees and you choose to give your life to that God. And Doug, who was a Christian, and myself, Christian, that was living a little bit more in the darkness than the light, we got on our knees and we said that third step prayer. We give, ostensibly, Doug was giving his life over to the will of God. And we stood up from that prayer and the light shined on me. I said, I don't know what's happening, but there was a palpable feeling of God moving in my life. And I said, I'm not going to drink again. I don't even know the exact date, but it was sometime in March of 96. I know the last day of my drink was February 4th of 96. But it happened. I had a bright life. I had an epiphany of feeling because I wanted it bad enough. And because I was willing to give it away. Trust me, I'm nothing special. I am a sinner saved by grace. But that's the message, that's the epiphany message. It's the message that King Abraham found. We can't find God in our silk clothes and in our golden bags. We find him in unexpected places where we give away a light and a love that is so powerful, it transforms us into something beyond ourselves. I'm not proud of where I was. I'm only proud that I can share the difference that God made in my life, that I was willing to say, God, I give it to you. I'm willing to help someone else. And that's why I'm proud to be in a church that says they want to give it away. They want to know how one another is hurting because we strive to be a loving, compassionate community sharing the love light with each other and the world. Let us pray. God, And the Magi follow the light to Christ. They were overwhelmed with joy. They had a journey back through sand and storms and carry on with life. They had to avoid King Herod. But they were overwhelmed with joy because they let that love light in. Let us recommit ourselves in this new year to being open to the love light. It will indeed drive out any darkness that we may feel. That is your promise, that no matter how cold, no matter how much our bodies break down, no matter what happens, that the love light will shine. And may it shine, and may we share. For Christ's sake, thanks for listening. Amen?
Amen. Amen.